Thank you. on the mountain when my Lord spoke. Out of his mouth came fire and smoke. I looked around me, it looked so fine. I asked the Lord if all were mine. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. The Jordan River is chilly and cold. It fills the body, but not the soul. There's only one train upon this track. It goes to heaven and right back. Every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray. Yes, every time I feel the Spirit moving in my heart, I will pray.
We will now have the scripture readings. This is from the New Testament, Philippians chapter 3, verses 4b through 14. Even though I too have reason for confidence in the flesh, if anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the eighth day, a member of the people of Israel of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews, as to the law of Pharisee, as to zeal, a persecutor of the church, as to righteousness under the law of blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard anything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard it as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the sharing of his sufferings by coming like him in his death, that somehow I may attain a resurrection from the dead. Pressing toward the goal, not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I have pressed on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Jesus Christ. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
Thank you for your patience. I know this is not the normal way we do things, but you know, with the presence of Christ and the Spirit, everything should be fluid. We will adapt whatever the situation there is before us, okay?
Yeah.
All right. Of course, all what we wanted is what is good and what is perfect, but it doesn't happen that way at times. So I know Zack when he informed me earlier about our projector, sometimes those are beyond our control sometimes when they do act like this. But that's not the center of our worship. It is Christ, the center, and it's the object of our worship. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, we thank you for this opportunity that we could come together to worship. Yes, we long to be with our brothers and sisters in faith, worshiping together, but Lord, we are limited by the situations we are experiencing and facing right now. But Lord God, wherever we are, you are the ever-present God. You are present everywhere. And we can worship you, oh God, wherever we are. And Lord, as we listen to your word, we pray that you turn your word into a living bread and feed our hungry souls. Help us to focus on the words of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Well, when we talk about success, we talk about probably our human instinct is about money, about wealth, about prestige, about all those accolades and the recognitions and all of the world could offer. Well, if you would go Google it, you may find, say, if you want to find lists of successful people in business, because the success is measured by so many measurements and not just kind of wealth or money. But just to give you a few, the name Andrew Carnegie, born in Scotland. He moved to America when he became very wealthy through dominating the U.S. Steel Company. And after selling his steel corporation in 1901, he gave away $350 million in the last 18 years of his life. 1901, $350 million, that's several billions of dollars in our present currency, or say, equivalent to our money today. John Rockefeller founded the Standard Oil in 1870. The firm soon gained monopoly power over the production and distribution of oil. And of course, at that time, he controlled 90% of U.S. oil. Wow. He was America's first billionaire and widely regarded as the richest man of the modern world. And his fortune at the time in 1913 peaked at $336 billion. Well, inflation adjusted. Now, how about those who are in our present times? Well, of course, we may say Bill Gates, American businessman, founder of Microsoft, and Steve Jobs, of course, a key figure in Apple computers, and credited with turning around Apple and overseeing the development of iPad and all these tablets that we know. Walt Disney, American film producer, and Disney developed cartoon characters, and of course Mickey Mouse is like the most popular one. Henry Ford, the one who promoted the auto revolution, mass producing Ford cars at very low cost. How about Oprah Winfrey, the most influential talk show host? Oprah has built a media empire built on her emotional approach. She has an estimated net wealth of $2.8 billion. Michael Jordan, of course, considered the greatest basketball player, but if you follow LeBron James, of course, you would disagree that, right? Serena Williams, the tennis superstar, is one of the most successful female tennis players, with a record of 38 Grand Slam and 19 single Grand Slam titles, you name it. She got all those championships. J.K. Rowling, the British author of Harry Potter series, which has become the best-selling series in history. Jeff Bezos is the world's wealthiest person for the third year in a row. The list goes on and on if you want to find the most successful people on the planet these days. I just mentioned people from the U.S. mostly. Paul, going back to the scripture, during this time, he would be considered the most successful personality in his time. Paul's, if you follow the scripture reading again, Paul's tremendous credentials as a Jewish leader, no one could come close. No one. His Jewish background, according to the law, he was circumcised on the eighth day, and that was the practice. And Paul's perfect score regarding everything that physical circumcision can mean. That means at the year, at eighth day, Paul already submitted to the law as observed during those days. So what is more of about Paul, about his bragging business? He had the right to brag. He said he came from the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew of Hebrews. What does it mean? 12 tribes of Israel? How come he was bragging about being came from the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew, the Greek Hebrews? The family background was like this. Joseph and Benjamin were the only two sons of Jacob and Rachel. And Rachel was Jacob's favorite wife. He had four, by the way. And Joseph and Benjamin were his favorite sons. That's why when Joseph was sold, Jacob was in tears, was really brokenhearted, and it was actually part of God's plan, was able to turn it for good. Paul is claiming to be a Hebrew of Hebrews. What does it mean? His parents schooled him in the Hebrew tradition of Aramaic language. So it's different. Hebrew language and Aramaic. And according to the tradition, Jesus spoke Aramaic, not just the ordinary Hebrew. So meaning, during those days, that's why he was bragging, I'm a Hebrew of Hebrews. Because those days, there were Hebrews who can speak Hebrews and Aramaic. And on the other hand, there were Hebrews who speak Greek. So that's why he was bragging, I am a pure Hebrew. I'm not a person who speaks another dialect and born or raised in a different culture, like in the Hellenistic culture. So he was bragging, and he had the right to say that. He was a pure Hebrew, as he claimed. In the New Testament times, the Jews were distinguished between those who live in Israel and those who live outside Israel. So same thing like probably in our present time, say those who can speak English only as the main language and others who could speak different dialects or languages. But for him to be able to speak Hebrew and Aramaic, wow, those are what we call the dying or breed at the time. His successes. In regard to the law, Paul was a Pharisee. At very young age, he was already a Pharisee and considered to be the youngest member of the Sanhedrin. It's like a council of lay people. And he was bragging at very young age. He was considered to be the youngest member of that party, of that religious group. And known for being, conservative and strict in following the Jewish law. If you want to find people who follow strictly the Jewish law, find a Pharisee, because they will correct you in every mistake you make, and they will tell you, that's not according to the law. That's how they were trained. As a seal, concerning loyalty to the Jewish faith, and traditions, he was bragging. He was persecuting the followers of the way. That was his loyalty to the party. If you are not part of the group, more likely you will be criticized and persecuted. That was his seal to persecute the church and the followers of Christ. And he, because of his zealousness to persecute the followers of the way, he was not happy just persecuting the Judean Christians. Christians, followers of Christ in Jerusalem. You know what he decided to do? He learned that there were some Christians in Syria and other places in Turkey. And you know what? He decided on one day to go and pursue and persecute them. And on his way to Damascus, what happened? All of a sudden, there was this moment that he experienced Christ personally. And he was, of course, saying something about that at the toward the start of his ministry. Concerning education, if you think you are bragging because you went to Harvard or Yale or the Ivy schools that we have here, or even Oxford, Saul at the time was bragging. He got the best teacher at the time, Rabbi Gamaliel, and probably, again, a member of the Jewish Sanhedrin. Well, Paul had something to be proud about. He had something to be proud of. If he would put together a resume, probably just the resume would be 3 or 4 pages, single space. And Paul, of all those accolades and of all of those accomplishments, he claimed, when he experienced Christ, when he experienced the Savior, he said, all of those I was bragging about, they were nothing. They were considered rubbish compared to the joy of knowing Jesus Christ, my Lord, compared to the joy of salvation and the promise of resurrection to the end. All of those were nothing. Church, that is the reality of life. As we age, I don't know. Every year I age, I think. Or every day I feel it. And yes, I got several degrees. When I get to that point now, I said, what are those? Those are just something we post on the wall. We get to the point where all your collections, all your everything you have accumulated, now we are on the downhill. And the common expression is, it is time to, what you call that, to cut down and to let go of a lot of things. Paul was like that. Paul's understanding of knowing the value of life in Christ was the most, life-transforming experiences he had. Paul explains that his conversion to Christ was a gain. All of a sudden, all of those, everything he had accomplished and gained, he said, all of those were nothing compared to that conversion he had about Christ. And suddenly, everything turned to be secondary and lost. He was even counting all of those gains as loss compared to gaining the understanding of following Christ. All of this, those following the law, from circumcision to the deeds of religious devotion, all of that was nothing. For the sake of Christ, all the standards he was putting out there turned upside down. Church, this is where what we call, when the law and the grace of Christ hit on, it is the grace of Christ that prevails. Paul, being in Christ means that our standing before God is not based on the law. No longer our law, the law is the basis for how we are turning to be nice and good and acceptable. It is now all about our relationship and faith in Christ. It is all about what Christ is doing in our lives. To have faith in Christ is to know Him. And to this knowledge means entering the radical transformation because of the resurrection that Christ has promised. Knowing Christ, we cannot run away. we cannot hide the transformation that Christ can bring. And lastly, knowing that Christian life is a process, Paul insists that the perfection is not here yet. I mean, perfection is not here yet. I know at times we brag that our kids is like is the best child all over the world, right? They're not perfect. They're not perfect. But this is one thing we're going to say to parents. We will not trade them for somebody else. If you say the ugly, say amen. They might not be perfect in the eyes of the world, but for us, they are perfect. Paul contends that life consists of, say, moving on, moving forward. We must press on because the price, if you think hundreds of billions of dollars is the best this world can offer, wherever you go, in the next life, none of that, not even a penny, could go with you, or could double and go with you, not even a dime. The price, according to Paul, is not what the world can offer, that can be taken away from us. You know the stock market. Here's the thing. You have $100 million before you went to bed. In the morning, it could be down to zero, right? Where is our security? We cannot put our security on something that can be taken away from us. One of my professors at Aslan Theological Center, Dr. Wardle, he said, do not put your life, your future, your joy on something that can be taken away from you. Our faith, our relationship with Christ is the only thing. Our hope for the new life and resurrection is the only thing that cannot be taken away from us. As church, just like Paul, we cannot live in the past. We are living in the present time so that we can live and adjust and survive in the future. Church, this is the reality. We cannot live in the past. We cannot. We can resist the chains the world is offering us. You can keep resisting it, but somehow at the end of the day, the world will never stop spinning, and you will come to the point, this is the way of life. We always move on. We move forward. Just like what Paul was saying, let us not live in the past. We are living in the present so that we can adjust and survive in the future. Don't compare yourself to other Christians. Because they have this, or you have this, they don't have that. You can do this, they cannot do that. Please, do not compare yourself to other Christians. Compare yourself to Christ. He is the one that we follow. Christ is the one that we follow. Knowing Christ means living the Christian life, so much so that nothing else matters. Knowing Christ means serving Christ and those around us, even to the point of losing one's life and in our life for Christ's sake. Church, is there something more valuable in this world and in our possession than the value and significance of knowing Jesus Christ, than knowing the value of Jesus Christ? Is there something worth pursuing in this life that only lasts for a while than the value of knowing and remaining in our faith in Christ till the end of time? As we struggle in this life, as we face the COVID-19 pandemic, as our faith is being tested each day and in every front, let us remain faithful, steadfast, and press on toward the goal of living with Christ till the end of time. Let us pray. Oh, gracious God, forgive us at times when we brag about anything, that we never had when we were born in this world. That means they were just accumulated, and they can be also discarded. They can be removed and taken away from us. But Lord God, that presence, your very presence in us when we were born, your spirit, when we were born, you breathe upon us your spirit, your presence. That's something that the world cannot be taken away from us. Help us, O God, to remain faithful till the end. Help us not to live in the past, but press on toward the future. Because the future brings a lot better part of our history. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, well, we are at this portion where you just wave. We just wave at each other. Okay. There you go. Good to see everybody here. And okay. Thank you. Wonderful. And I know you're all smiling behind those masks, right? Okay. Next. Go ahead. Next slide. Okay. A reminder, by the way, we're having an individual cups for communion. If you didn't have one yet, if you didn't get one yet when you entered, please raise your hands so we can give you. Okay, we got two hands or three yet. Please give them communion. Elements. Okay. All right. As you leave the lamp, pass the offering plates as well, or basket. As you leave the sanctuary, we have a basket on by the exit here. So you may put your offerings there, or you may mail them to the church, however, whatever is convenient for you. Okay? So as we exit the church, please take the side aisles when you exit, and please try to keep the distance away from each other, at least 6 feet. Okay? All right. Anything else? Any other announcement? Okay, here's the other announcement thing. This morning, when I heard about the news again, the virus is surging again. And Ohio, we are under the 10 to 50% surge. And that is very alarming, of course. There's no vaccine. And this morning I was thinking, there is a possibility again, if this will not be really addressed on time or right away now, there is again an option for us that we will be doing just online services. So we are not ruling that out. Okay? So please, church, let us be fluid. We will remain connected, but we will not compromise the safety of everybody. Okay? We will not compromise. I know we can worship God wherever we are and whatever media platform, and thank God for that. And I thank Zack and Maggie for helping us here to stay connected. But I know you will be disappointed. I too, me too, but there's nothing we could do more. But we will try our best. Okay? All right. Okay, next slide, please. Okay, oh, okay. Let us pray for Jean Freely. I was just informed by Vivian that Jean will undergo, Jean Freely is our partner, and Jean Freely will undergo a surgery on the 20th of this month, so October 20th. So please remember Jean Freely in your prayers. And also Greg, her husband, his cancer came back. So both of them are dealing with this cancer issue. So please, if you could send them cards, please do so. Just to boost their emotion and feelings. Give them encouraging words, okay? If you can. Any other announcement? Yes? So thank God. And actually today is Blossom's fourth birthday. So this young Blossom. Okay. All right. Happy birthday.
Brokenness,
joys and our concern. Because once they are in your hands, you can turn them over into something magnificent. All of this we pray in the name of Christ, our Lord, the one who taught us how to pray. Together,
our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name, thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us
not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom,
and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Okay, before we go to the communion, I just want to let you know, Emily Holiday delivered some, she informed me that we have some face shield. They are right there as you exit. So if you need a face shield, it's free. Please, please get one or two, whatever you want. Okay? Today actually is World Communion Sunday. Meaning in the past few years we've been doing like dressed in different national attires, right, from other countries. But we cannot do that this time. So, but maybe I want to thank Marva for the preparation here. It's amazing. Are those real bread?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wonderful. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory
to God.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and our praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join your unending hymns.
Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your
Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave up himself for us, he took bread. Give thanks to you, broke the bread, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." When the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And so, in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ offered for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is alive, Christ is risen, Christ will come again.
Pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. May them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in the Holy Church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
Ang katawan ni Jesus, ipinagkaloob sa inyo. The body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Ang dugo ni Jesus, ipinagkaloob sa inyo. The blood of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Church, you may first just the plastic cover, okay? You pull that first to get the wafer. The body of Christ given for you.
Amen.
Take and eat in remembrance of Jesus Christ. And then the second lid, the cover to get to the grape juice. The blood of Christ shed for you. Take and drink in remembrance of Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Oh gracious God, today mark the day for all the Christians, the followers and disciples of Christ, speaking in different languages, are celebrating the very presence of Christ in our midst. Thank you, O God, for giving your life, for sacrificing your life, just to win and express your love to ordinary people, just like me, just like us. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.